Yisrayl.
Israel, Yisrayl.
Horse of war.
Back.
I'm the hardest one there is.
I'm the hardest one ever.
They say I'm the last of the dying creed, but I disagree. God gave me strength for the work that's ahead of me. I've been blessed by the Yahuah to step on top. It's the birth of a legend. Jarrell Yisrael switched out the darkness. I turned on the light and I spit out the hardest. Yo man say he fire regardless. If he don't spit his verse for Messiah, he gone. I'm in the land where they burn crosses, where they hang you from them first. They catch you out in the market. It's the melanin that brings out the hell in them. Return to the Most High, y'all's what I'm telling them. I ain't buying it, even though they selling it, the left behind theory. Matthew 24, pay attention closely. Read through it slowly. See that the rapture is not...
She loves everyone.
Yeah.
See us next week.
It did not automatically start the recording. Okay. So let me play the best one. You know about the internet struggles. So yeah, family, if y'all want to come to the mic, feel free before we pick it up. And again, just bear with me. I'll get the editing done. I did get the recording for the priesthood done this morning, and I'll edit it and post it. Y'all willing for Tuesday evening, as usual.
Yeah.
Yeah. We were thinking about just how interesting it was that most of the people that we communicated with anyway all had very, very busy weeks. It's like it was almost like a cohesiveness of being able to empathize and almost wondering if God's putting us in a position where we kind of going through similar things. At the same time.
I remember what the coach Latasha said in the group last night. She said, I'm gonna read it exactly how she said, because I was like, absolutely. She said, this week of trials for the nation, but praise Yah for his rest.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Okay. Shabbat shalom, coach.
Shabbat shalom, sir.
Yeah. And she said that, I was like, that's on point. She nailed that, because that's exactly what it felt like.
Their rest is it never fails to be exactly on time. Mm-hmm. Just about when you feel like you at your wit's end and just can't take any more.
Sign the deck, guy. Y'all had to say that.
Anyway. Suicide? Yeah, I think I found enough.
Yeah, that's
what
that's,
did it say? I can't take any more.
Sign the deck, guy. That's a good idea. Doc, that's a good idea.
Analyze it.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's how it is, you know, and that rest is right on time to get back grounded, to get back rooted, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I know we say that often, but this thing happens in cycles, you know. I got a theory about us going through a miniature version of Yah's plan of deliverance. So his ultimate plan of deliverance ending with the ultimate rest being condensed into weekly trials. And so we know that we have a weekly Sabbath, but we also know that we're striving for a forever Sabbath. And that ultimate rest, you have to be, I won't say perfect, but you got to walk a narrow road. Abraham said, that road too narrow, only a baby could fit on.
Only a baby could fit in.
Right? And we know that the wide road is the road that leads to destruction. Mm-hmm. Thus says, yeah. And so my theory is that just as Dawid spoke about the valley of the shadow of death, in my understanding, I'm being very clear to say that, so nobody say, that's not what the book said. Mm-hmm. This is how I understand it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm able to kind of pull out and extract things that I think help with my walk. And what I see is that the valley of the shadow of death, in my opinion, is this life. this life that we're dealing with right now is not the shadow of life.
I know.
Life, mm-hmm. the life that y'all want for us, this ain't the shadow of it.
Mm-hmm.
It's wicked. It's erroneous.
Yeah.
The people who are not supposed to rule are in power. Right? This is the valley of the shadow of death. And so as Dawid was saying, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Thy rod and thy staff, can you just mute mm-hmm. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. I'm thinking, that's my week. That's my week. We have to take up that mantle just to get through the week. And then when the Sabbath comes, then you can take a break and say, oh, now I can get with my family in Yah,
mm-hmm.
and I can regroup. I can ask Yah for that rejuvenation that there is no interruption from the outside world from. You know, you get your family going to interrupt. My wife going to interrupt me, no matter what. My children going to interrupt me, no matter.
It's like I was telling the children today, we was watching this news clip where somebody had posted on TikTok about a guy who was saying how they had him on the news about how the showers that we take is killing us because of the chlorine in the water. And so he was saying that the way chlorine, because of the pores in our skin,
yeah.
So if we run a tub of bath water. Yeah. When we get in, the chlorine, our skin will suck up the chlorine within seconds.
That makes sense.
And so just like suck the chlorine clean out of the water. So he did a little test.
Yeah.
He took three glasses and got some tap water and poured water in all three glasses.
Okay.
And then he put those pool drops that's designed to spot chlorine, how strong it
shock.
Is. Yeah.
Shock.
Shock true.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, when you put it in there, it turn yellow if it's like chlorine. Right.
Ultra chlorinated.
Right.
Yeah.
So he put the drops in one glass and the water turned yellow. It was a lot of chlorine in the water. And then he said for the second glass, first, I'm going to stick my fingers in there first just to show you how quick chlorine your skin absorb it.
Mm-hmm.
So he put his fingers in there and then like for just a couple seconds. The minute he put the yellow drops in there, no chlorine, because his pores had sucked up the chlorine just that quick. And then he did it for the third glass. And you know what I'm saying? No, he put a potato in the third glass to show you how your food absorbed the chlorine, no chlorine. And so I was telling the children, I'm like, you know what? Listen, in this world today, in this valley of death, Everything is designed to kill us.
Yep.
And so you really got to remember Psalms 91.
Yeah.
Although tens of thousands fall at your right. And you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You be okay. The next news clip that came along is how the zombie virus is growing. So like more people, whereas in 2019, when they first saw this virus, just a few people may have died from it. Versus like 2020 and 2021, 2022, where the numbers have grown up,
right.
You know, so each year the virus get bigger and bigger or whatever may have you. And I say, children, listen, scripture say these things is going to happen. The only thing you could do is be protected by the law. So it say that the law is our shield.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? So if you following Abiyah's law, that's your shield. It's kind of like, if you moving through a maze and you blindfold and you just, if you just follow the law that was taught for you. So you have a law that teaches you how to move through this maze blindfolded. So your law could be, you know, take three steps to the right, take three steps to the left, go straight two steps, then make a sharp right.
Right.
Now, if you follow that, you making it through this maze.
Right.
But if you don't, you're not going to make it.
Absolutely.
And so that's kind of like what the law is to us. It's like, listen, don't eat what you're not supposed to eat.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Scripture say what it says. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Man, and just like follow Abiyah's laws. You're gonna be all right.
Thinking of the videos, we just watched two videos this morning with our sons. And there's a brother who is Yah. He wound up being featured on ESPN.
Mm-hmm.
Because he has a...
Oh, wait a minute. You said there's a brother. Who's Yah? Or who? It's Yah that he was featured?
I said it's Yah. It's just Yah that he was featured.
Okay, okay. Man. Okay.
Hold on.
Yeah, because you know, Rose.
It's Yah that he was able to be featured on ESPN, knowing what he knows. He knows who he is. Mm-hmm. He knows who we are. And he teaches that, but he doesn't bash people with it. And so he has a school of discipline that he calls the Cave of Adullam. If you're not familiar, the Cave of Adullam, we talked about it last week, is the cave that Dawid hid in. And his school is for young boys that need extra discipline. Mm-hmm. But the psychology of it, and thinking about what you just said, to observe the law with a strict discipline, knowing that this is that narrow path that's going to guard you from the slings and arrows of the adversary. I'm thinking of like, and because I'm, you know, a man out of Wu-Tang, Samurai Sunday and all that, I'm thinking of like the blind swordsman. You can walk by faith as opposed to by sight, because especially these days with the deep fakes and all,
man,
your sight may get you plucked up.
Show.
You say, I think I see this, let me move over there. Or I think I heard this now. And we always heard the saying, believe none of what you hear and only half of what you see.
Yep.
But now you may not be able to believe any of either.
The deep fakes and artificial intelligence.
And so to walk by faith and not by sight, I'm thinking of the blind swordsman that's tiptoeing through them woods with all the samurais in the bamboos falling out the trees. And it's just that blind discipline that my muscle memory of doing this over and over is what's protecting me.
Yeah.
I've practiced this repetitiously over and over. I know the correct moves. When this happens, it's like a kata. My children, we know they do the taekwondo and the martial arts. When you're practicing that, you are getting your muscles used to when this, then that, when this, then that. You don't think, you simply react.
Yeah.
And that type of discipline, I think, is what's going to preserve those of us who are preserved to get us to where we need to be in the time we need to be there.
Okay, I agree. Yeah. I agree. So, you know, it's like, it's no need to even fear. You know, somebody was saying the chemtrails killing us. So the air is dangerous, the water is dangerous, the food is dangerous, the clothes you put on your back is dangerous. Now they're saying
it. And the fear is another attack of the
adversary. Exactly.
So you got all the stuff attacking you, and then the fear is another
swing. So that's stress. You know what I'm saying? But faith, you know, remember, faith is faith. Being able to know without a shadow of a doubt that the Most High got you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So my faith. And another thing that gives me comfort is, I believe in Abba Yah, and I believe in his infinite wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that no matter what, when Abba Yah say it's time. And guess what? Ain't gonna stop it. Yeah. Vitamins, doctors, surgery, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
People watching my back, a wall, a fence, a gate, you know, ain't not, when the Most High say, okay, now it's time. And when it's not time, guess what's not gonna happen?
Mm-hmm.
Ain't no, I just seen a video where a man was sitting in his van, and I don't know if he was on his phone or what, but his light turned green, and instead of him like making sure it was clear before it was a truck running the light at the last minute, and a truck hit him, his whole van fell apart. I mean, completely fell apart, and he just rolled out the way and got up like, and somebody said, when it ain't your time, it ain't your time. What can you do? I mean, you know what I'm saying? That man got hit and fell apart.
The police officer, we just saw the video.
Yeah.
He was trying to write somebody a ticket.
Yes.
The car was parked where Rib is.
Mm-hmm.
His squad car was parked here. He was up at this window, and somebody came from the opposite direction across a teenager in a BMW. Came across, speeding, hit that car, and that officer turned around, dove out the way, and it tore that car off. And he got up. You can see he was cussing. He was throwing his ticket.
Yeah. he probably quit. I quit. You know what I'm saying? But that's just it.
If it take this no more.
If it ain't your time, you ain't going nowhere. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And if it is your time, I trust the Most High. If the Most High says time, Reb, then what? I trust you. Mm-hmm. Then it's time. You know? I look at Methuselah. Was that Methuselah? Noah's father?
I won't lie.
Okay. Methuselah was a righteous man. A righteous man.
About Noah's father?
Well, Noah's father. Was it right? Okay. Lamech?
I think Noah's father is Lamech.
Lamech? Okay. Yeah. But I think I'm talking about Methuselah, which was Lamech's father.
Okay.
And he was a righteous man. He was a good priest of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And the Messiah, and Abiyah say, I'm going to take you before the flood comes because I don't want you to see that.
Right. Right.
I don't want you to live through those terrors. You know what I'm saying? And so he took him so that he didn't have to live through what came on the earth. So let me tell you something. If Abiyah say,
Lamech.
If Abiyah say, Rib, is your time? I trust you.
But it was Methuselah that died before the flood. Yeah.
That was right. Methuselah, right. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Because he was a righteous person. And Abiyah didn't want, could you imagine the terrors of the earth flood? You know what I'm saying? He said, I don't want you to live through that. Not that you know what I'm saying? Just that it'll be better for you to rest in Abraham's bosom.
Okay.
While this terror sweep over the earth.
Hallelujah. Let me, slight change. So let me say this, family. It was not the same recording the priesthood study this morning without y'all being live, without reading for me and the banter that we have back and forth. Y'all got to help me remember to make sure that, and Reb caught it this morning because I thought it was recording again.
Yeah.
Y'all got to help me remember that if we don't hear that recording, we are not recording because I'm dry. I'm not entertaining.
Dry eye.
Yeah.
You know me.
Hello, friends. Are we ready to begin? I was ready for the day. Same song.
Hello, friends.
Enough about us.
Yes.
Family, it's a blessing to have you guys with us. Officially, welcome to another study session with us as we do our next edition of Studying Scriptures.
Cain.
You are here with your Ox, Shlomo Ben Israel. I am joined by the beautiful, talented, and lovely
Rip Gaia.
And today we are picking up in the book of Judges, mm-hmm. chapter 19.
Okay.
Is that correct, y'all? I asked my children, what chapter are we picking up on?
19.
So we're reading today 19, 20, and 21. All right.
All right.
You want to start, Mama? That's going to take us to the end. All right. Congratulations, family.
Yeah, we is knocking it. We is knocking
it. Samuel. You want to start or you want me to start?
Either way.
Pick one.
I guess I can start.
It's up to you.
Okay. Okay, and it came to be in those days when there was no sovereign in Israel that there was a certain Levite sojourning on the farther side of the mountains of Ephraim. And he took for himself a concubine from Bethlehem in Yehuda.
Mm.
And his concubine committed whoring against him and went away from him to her father's house to Bethlehem in Yehuda, and was there 4 new moons of days.
Oh, wow.
You know this story. Yeah.
4 months.
This is hard.
Okay.
And her husband arose and went after her to speak to her heart and bring her back, having his servant and a couple of donkeys with him. And she brought him into her father's house, and the father of the young woman saw him, and he was glad to meet him. And his father-in-law, the young woman's father, took hold of him, and he dwelt with him 3 days. And they ate and they drank, and they spent the nights there. And it came to be on the 4th day that they arose early in the morning, and he prepared to leave. But the young woman's father-in-law said to his son-in-law, refresh your heart with a piece of bread, and afterward go on your way. So they sat down, and the 2 of them ate and drank together. And the young woman's father said to the man, please agree to stay all night and let your heart be glad.
Mm-hmm.
And when the man arose to go, his father-in-law urged him. So he spent the night there again.
Mm-hmm.
And he arose early in the morning on the fifth day to go, but the young woman's father said, please refresh your heart. So they delayed until afternoon, and both of them ate. And so just, so when it's worded like that, it's hard for you to see yourself in this. But let me show you how this probably went down. Hey, don't, y'all get ready to get out of here? No, listen. We're gonna start the grill. You know what I'm saying? My wife, you know, she done made up a batch of that new wine.
You remind me of the band.
Okay, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Don't go yet, brother. You know, young man, you know, I like you. Come, you know, we're gonna have some links. You know what I'm saying? That's kind of how it went.
In addition, I would also point out that there was a rift between husband and wife.
Mm-hmm.
And so he mm-hmm. came to retrieve his wife. And so if they still hadn't settled whatever the rift was, the wife's family was probably trying to keep them there in Shalom.
To work it out
amongst family. Like, no, it ain't worked out yet. Y'all stay a little bit long.
Yeah.
Work it out, you know?
So when it says she went a horn, you know, I'm wondering, because like, it never like, when it, like, did she go, like, you know, out swinging on them or what? Did she, you know, was she in love with a younger man? And, you know, I don't know. But anyway, so he arose early. So, okay. And the man arose to go, and he and his concubine and his servant. But his father-in-law, the young woman's father, said to him, see, the day is now drawing toward evening. Please spend the night. See, the day is coming to an end. Stay here and let your heart be glad. And you shall rise early tomorrow for your journey, and you shall go to your tent. But the man would not stay that night, and he arose and he left and came to a place opposite Yebus, that is Yerushalem. And with him were the two saddled donkeys and his concubine with him.
Mm-hmm.
They were near Yebus. So this is his concubine and not his wife.
Mm-hmm. It's a very similar thing.
Like a girlfriend. Like his girlfriend.
Well, we didn't really have the concept of girlfriend in our culture. Mm-hmm. So this concubine meant it wasn't his wife, but it was a woman who they had a contractual agreement with, meaning it's his concubine.
Mm-hmm.
He's paying for everything that he would do for a wife, he's doing for her.
Mm-hmm.
She's just not his wife.
Mm-hmm. Right. So they have an agreed upon time to be together. So, you know what I'm saying? So, like, it's like a, you know, like they were still doing that as early as like the 1800s. I'm thinking where they was like, you know, you my concubine for 6 months, or, you know, there's an actual agreement.
Yeah.
You know. So, and the man arose, they were near Yebus, and the day was far spent. And the servant said to his master, please come and let us turn aside into the city of Yebusites and spend the night in it. And his master said to him, let us not turn aside here into the city of foreigners who are not of the children of Israel,
mm-hmm.
but we shall pass over to Gibeah. And he said to his servant, come, let us draw near to one of these places and spend the night in Gibeah or in Ramah. And they passed over and went their way. And the sun went down on them near Gibeah, which belongs to Benjamin. And they turned off there to go in to spend the night in Gibeah. So he went in and he sat down in the open square of the city, for no one would take them into their house to spend the night. But see, an old man came in from his work in the field at evening, who also was from the mountains of Ephraim. And he was sojourning in Gibeah, whereas the man of the place were Benjamites. And when he lifted his eyes, he saw the traveler in the open square of the city. And the old man said, where are you going and where do you come from? And he said to him, we are passing over from Bethlehem in Yehuda to the other side of the mountains of Ephraim. And I mean, I am from there, and I went to Bethlehem in Yehuda, and I am going to the house of Yahuah, but there is no one taking me into his house. Yet there is both straw and fodder for our donkeys, and bread and wine for myself and for your female servant, and for the young man who is with your servant, there is no lack of any matter. And the old man said, peace be with you. However, let all of your needs be on me. Only do not spend the night in the open square. He brought him into his house and gave fodder to the donkeys and washed his feet and ate and drank. And they were making their hearts glad. And see, men of the city, sons of Belial, surrounded the house, beating on the door. And they spoke to the master of the house, the old man, saying, bring out the man who came to your house so that we know him.
Mm-hmm. But
the man, they didn't want the woman. They wanted the man, the priest, the priest. But the man, the master of the house, went out to them and said to them, no, my brothers, I beg you, do no evil. Since this man has come into my house, do not do this folly. Look, here's my maid and daughter and the man's concubine. Let me bring them out now and humble them and do with them what is good in your eyes. But do not do such a foolish matter to this man. But the man would not listen to him. So the man took hold of his concubine and brought her out to them. And they knew her and rolled themselves on her all night until morning and let her go when the day began to break. And as morning appeared, the woman came back and fell down at the door of the man's house where her master was till it was light. Mm-hmm. And her master rose up in the morning and opened the door of the house and went out to go his way. And he saw his concubine falling at the door of the house with her hands on the threshold. And he said to her, rise up and let us go. But there was no answer. Then he took her on the donkey, and the man rose and went to his place and came into his house and took a knife. Then he took hold of his concubine and cut her up limb by limb into 12 pieces and sent her throughout all the borders of Israel. And it came to be that all who saw and said, there has never been, and there has not been since the like of this, from the day the children of Israel came up from the land of Israel to this day. Set your heart on it, take counsel, and speak up.
So, yeah, that is heavy. So, as I read this, this reads to me like this brother is laying the guilt of what happened to her on all of Israel, on all 12 tribes, to cut her up in 12 pieces and to send portions of her to each of the 12 tribes, saying, you are all guilty of what has been done to this. Mm-hmm. Now, I took a second to look up that word because it does say concubine in the English translation, mm-hmm. but that word is H802. In the Hebrew, it is Isha.
Okay.
That word is Isha. First form is the feminine, it's the feminine form of Ish. Mm-hmm. So literally Ish is man, literally Isha is woman, but is also considered to mean man as in husband man and woman as in.
Right, because they would say his father-in-law.
His father-in-law.
So I wonder why they translated it concubine. That's probably them being too helpful.
I think that because of what happened to her, there is. See, as we read here, it says the second form is an irregular plural, a woman used in the same sense as enosh, mortal, general, adulteress, each, every female. Mm. So I think because of what happened to her, maybe why the translators, and I'm not saying that's a fact. I'm just saying, I'm trying to understand why conjugate the verb in that way when the literal word, the literal Hebrew is the same as wife. And then we read, as you said, I didn't even think about that, father-in-law. So not only did we look at it, as she was reading, I looked it up. Not only did we look at it in the KJV, but I'm here in my Strong's looking at it in the Hebrew version. And just to do a little further digging, and when I look at it in the Hebrew version, it is, again, Isha. Even in the original Hebrew, it is Isha. Now, the reason I wanted to make sure that was accurate is because, as we talked about this last time, there were some parallels here that I see between Hamashiach, Israel, and this priest, mm-hmm. and his wife. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because this priest, definitely. being in the position of priest and husband, mm-hmm. like Hamashiach is in the position of priest and husband, was dealing with a wife that decided she did not want her husband. Yeah. She left her husband and went ahori. Israel left our husband and went ahori. Mm-hmm. And the husband loved her so much that he didn't say, I'm done with her. She's gone to her, a whoring.
He went after her.
Sure did. And then when he found her, was willing to take her back. And then even after what happened to her
was willing
outside,
still
when she was laying at the door, mm-hmm. knowing what had happened to her, was telling her, come on, get up. It's okay. Let's go.
Yeah.
And then realized she was dead. And it was too late.
See, the scriptures read, you know, the scriptures don't take the time to put detail into things. But this man was grieving. This man loved her. He loved her enough to, after she cheated on him, to still go after her.
That's
you know.
Yeah, we would all, as righteous, our king, want to say, yeah, of course. Let's be honest. That's a difficult thing to say you could do.
Mm-hmm.
And most of us say we would not, if we just being honest. Like, mm-hmm. She go, woo, 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 I'm done.
That's a wrap.
But what if Messiah did the same thing with us?
Oof.
Right? And so this is a similitude. This is a picture of Messiah right here mm-hmm. in what we just read. The way this priest loved this wife of his and him. Maybe he had another wife. I don't know. Maybe that's why they translated it. Concubine. I don't know. But that was Messiah like to me.
Yeah, he was torn up enough that, you know, let's finish reading.
Yeah, that's it. Happened. Okay, chapter 20. And all the children of Israel came out from Dan to Beersheba and from the land of Gilead, and the congregation assembled as one man before Yahuah at Mitzvah. And the leaders of all the people, all the tribes of Israel, presented themselves in the assembly of the people of Elohim, 400,000. Foot soldiers who drew the sword. And the children of Benjamin heard that the children of Israel had gone up to Mitzvah, and the children of Israel said, speak up. How did this evil come about? And the man, the Levite, husband of the woman, there you go again, husband of the woman who was murdered, answered and said, my concubine and I went into Gibeah, which belongs to Benjamin, to spend the night. And the masters of Gibeah rose against me and surrounded the house at night because of me. They thought to kill me, but instead they humbled my concubine, and she died. Then I took my concubine and cut her into pieces and sent her throughout all the land of the inheritance of Israel, because they committed wickedness and folly in Israel. Can you imagine the mind state of this man to be cutting up the body of the woman that he loved into 12 pieces in order to send it to his tribesmen to say, this is your fault? I cannot imagine.
And a lot of people say, you know, why didn't he go out instead of her? First of all, he don't belong to himself. He's a Levitical priest. Had they did that to him, I would have raised that whole area. That whole area, like, for the sake of that man who owned that house, probably begged him, because that man didn't.
That's
only,
what it reads like.
He didn't only send out his concubine; he sent out his daughter too.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? Because he like, if they do this to a Levitical priest,
yes,
we're all dead.
So let's go ahead. Sodom and Gomorrah. Parallel those two stories again, because we were talking about angels of Yah. In the story of Sodom and Gomorrah, right?
Mm-hmm.
But when we read the word angels in the Hebrew, it's melakim.
Mm-hmm.
The word melakim can translate to angels, but it can also simply mean messenger mm-hmm. of Yah.
Mm-hmm.
This Levitical priest was in the same vein, stands in the same authority as the melakim,
mm-hmm.
being he is a messenger of Yah.
Mm-hmm.
And so this man pleading with those people the same way Lot pleaded with those people,
mm-hmm.
please don't do this to this man. If you do this to this man,
this is
all of us.
You don't even know what you're doing. You don't even know what you're bringing down on our head.
Even though this was a man and not an angel.
Mm-hmm.
And so they sent, and I know this is hard to grasp. They sent the women out there So the men wouldn't come in and do it anyway.
And thinking that maybe they'll go easier on the women because they didn't really want women. They was into men to begin with. So he probably was telling him, like, you know, they gay. You know, they ain't into women. They going to just one or two people may sleep with her. But she'll be okay. You know, it'll be, trust me, you know, I'm sending my daughter too. But you can't go out there because, I mean, I rained down fire on this whole area. You know what I'm saying?
And I think with y'all, there's no coincidences. I think that we only get this similitude and this mirror image with mm-hmm. that happening. And we also only get a better understanding of the relationship and a dynamic between Yisrayl and Hamashiach with seeing that she went a-whoring first.
Yes, she did.
Like Yisrayl went a-whoring first. Mm-hmm. And what happened to Yisrayl happened to Yisrayl. The things that have been done to us as we've been scattered, as we've been conquered, as we've been, what's the word, occupied, mm-hmm. even when we were in our land, when people came and occupied our land, those things are the equivalent of, spiritually, what happened with this woman mm-hmm. for a nation. Mm-hmm. To be raped, to be pillaged, to be robbed, mm-hmm. to be sodomized as a nation, to be scattered abroad, Mm-hmm. dissected into many and then tossed and scattered to the mm-hmm. four corners, just like this woman was. We only get that picture if this happens.
And then for her adultery, death is
supposed to happen. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, but he loved her. So of course he didn't pick up the rock to stone her, but then Abiyah allowed this to happen to her. You know what I'm saying? And then if you live in America, like if America redo this story, America probably redo this story with him being old and she being young, and he saw her and wanted her, and she loved a young man first, a young she village lad. And she broke away from him because he was so old, and she went running to her village lad, and they had the best, beautiful week of their life before he came to retrieve her. When he came, you know what I'm saying? The fact is, that's the agenda. But the fact is, what happened was, this is your husband, and you went a whoring on your husband, and Abiyah allowed you to be murdered brutally. You know, Akoti Latasha.
I had a question as far as like where it says the sons of Balaam, because we know like Balaam is. So was those mixed people in, or was those the tribe of Benjamin sons that went off to start worshiping Baal?
So remember, we were just talking about this last week with Eli's two sons. Mm-hmm. Eli's family and Phinehas were Levites. But we read that they were sons of Baal because it says they were worthless, meaning they were wicked.
So remember, the Messiah said, "You are of your father, the devil."
Yeah.
So Belial is another term for Satan. So basically, they saying they were sons of wickedness.
Yeah. Now that's not to discredit the possibility that there was also other nations there, because in this area, I do believe there were other nations.
Yeah,
there
they were the Edomites. When some other nation was living with them, mm-hmm. Canaanites or something. Yeah.
And so, I do believe that it was a group of mixed multitude at that door doing what they did, but some of them were Israelites. Mm-hmm. We're gonna read some of them were Israelites as well. Mm-hmm. And they were still sons of Belial, mm-hmm. according to Torah, because of what was on their hearts mm-hmm. and because they did not know Yah. Mm-hmm. Same what we say about Hophni and Phinehas.
Okay.
They did not know Yah. Otherwise, they would have banded together to stop what happened to this priest's wife.
Because that's not lawful. What you did, that's another man's, like, so you brought death on all y'all here. That's another man's wife.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And you violated another man's wife. Every man that touched her got to die according to law.
Yeah. Okay.
Hey, where you leave out? Did you even start? Did you?
I did. Seven.
Okay. You left off at six.
So, I sent her throughout all the land of the inheritance of Yisrayl, because they committed wickedness and folly in Israel. Look, you are all children of Israel. Speak and give your counsel here. And all the people rose as one man, saying, let not one of us go into his tent, nor any of us turn back to his house. And now, let this, what we do to Geba, go against it by lot. And we shall take 10 men out of every 100 throughout all the tribes of Israel, and 100 out of every 1,000, and 1,000 out of every 10,000, to make food for the people, to prepare for their going to Geba in Benjamin for war, for all the folly they did in Israel. And all the men in Israel were gathered against the city, knit together as one man.
Mm.
And the tribes of Israel sent men throughout all the tribe of Benjamin, because it was Benjamin mixed in with those other people in Geba, saying, what is this evil that has come about amongst you, brother? Now, give us the men, the sons of Belial, who are in Geba, so that we put them to death and put away the evil from Israel. Or don't, it's up to you.
Right.
But the children of Benjamin would not listen to the voice of their brothers and the children of Israel, their brothers, the children of Israel. So the children of Benjamin gathered together from their cities to Geba to go to battle against the children of Israel. So now you're going to go to war with them people against your own people.
But they have, remember, Benjamin was one of them tribes that we read that they did not fully run them Canaanites out.
That's right.
And so they started to live together with them, to marry with them, and to, you know.
It's them Canaanites. And from their cities at that time, the children of Benjamin registered 26,000 men who drew the sword.
Mm.
Besides the inhabitants of Geba, who registered 700 chosen men. Among all these people were 700 chosen men who were left-handed.
Mm.
Each one could sling a stone at a hair's breadth and not miss.
Wow.
And besides Benjamin, the men of Israel registered 400,000 men who drew the sword. All of these were men of battle. And the children of Israel rose and went up to Beth El to ask of Elohim, and they said, who of us goes up first to battle? Which tribe is what they asked? Which tribe should go first against the children of Benjamin? And Yahuah said, Yehuda first.
Mm.
And the children of Israel rose in the morning and encamped against Geba, and the men of Israel went out to battle against Benjamin. And the men of Israel put themselves into battle array to fight against them at Geba. And the children of Benjamin came out against Geba. And the children of Benjamin came out of Geba on that day, cut down to the ground 22,000 men of Israel.
Mm.
22,000 men of Israel. But the people, the men of Israel, strengthened themselves and again formed the battle line at the place where they had put themselves in array on the first day. They regrouped, they regathered, they came back to their line and said, okay, everybody, siege forward again. We're going to draw this line. Let's not back behind this line.
Chapter 20, verse 23, is it?
Yes. And the children of Israel went up and wept before Yahuah until evening, and asked of Yahuah, saying, should I again draw near for battle against the children of my brother Benjamin? And Yahuah said, go up against him. And the children of Israel drew near to the children of Benjamin on the second day. And Benjamin went out against them from Geba on the second day and cut down to the ground 18,000 more of the children of Israel. All these drew the sword. I want y'all to think back to how Rear keep pointing out, I think we talked about this last week as well, how Yah oftentimes does this thing where he takes the small, the little, to do great things. Well, Benjamin was at 27,000 plus 700 of the men of Geba. Israel came with 400,000. That's too many. That's too many. And you go to war against your own people. So they have now cut these Israelites down to where it's a more measurable size.
Mm.
Let's see what happens. I don't want to speak out of turn. So let's see. Says Benjamin went out against them from Geba on the second day. We read that already. Is that where I left off?
Mm-hmm. Wait, no, you're on
26. And all the children of Israel, even all the people, went up and came to Bethel and wept and sat there before Yahuah and fasted that day until evening. And they offered ascending offerings and peace offerings before Yahuah. And the children of Israel asked of Yahuah the Ark of the Covenant of Elohim was there in those days. Okay. And Phinehas, son of Eleazar, son of Aharon, stood before it in those days, saying, which priest lineage is he from? Y'all remember from last week? Is he from the lineage of Ithamar or from the lineage of Eleazar?
Eleazar. It says son of Eleazar.
Phinehas. Right. And so that's the lineage that Zadok comes through,
mm-hmm.
not the lineage that Eli comes through, mm-hmm. and his two sons hop into Phinehas. Boys, so right. This is not that Phinehas. This is the other Phinehas. Yes. Okay? So we know what Phinehas we're talking about. We can pretty much guess where this is going to go.
Okay. Okay, good deal. Right.
So son of Eleazar, son of Aharon, stood before it in those days, saying, should I yet again go out to battle against the children of my brother Benjamin, or should I cease? And Yahuah said, go up, for tomorrow I give them into your hand.
Mm.
And Israel set ambushes all around the bar. And the children of Israel went up against the children of Benjamin on the third day and put themselves in battle array against the bar. Mm-hmm. As at other times. And the children of Benjamin came out to meet the people, drawn away from the city. And they began to strike some of the people slain as at other times in the highways, of which one went up to Bethel and the other to Geba in the field, about 30 men of Israel. And the children of Benjamin said, they are going to be smitten before us as previously. But the children of Israel said, let us flee and draw them away from the city to the highways. And all the men of Israel rose from their place and put themselves in battle array at Baal Tamar. And the ambush of Israel broke forth from their position at Mount Mara Geba. And 10,000 chosen men from all Israel came against Geba, and the battle was fierce, but they did not know that calamity was close to them. And Yahuah, not Israel, and Yahuah smote Benjamin before Israel. And the children of Israel destroyed 25,100 men on that day in Benjamin. All these drew the sword. And the children of Benjamin saw that they were smitten, and the men of Israel had given ground to the Benjamites because they trusted in the ambush that they had set against Geba. And the ambush hurried and came against Geba. And the ambush spread out and struck the entire city with the edge of the sword. And the appointed signal between the men of Israel and the ambush was that when they would make a great cloud of smoke rise up from the city, then the men of Israel would turn in battle. And Benjamin began to strike dead about 30 of the men of Israel, for they said, they are indeed smitten before us as at the first battle. Then the cloud began to rise from the city in a column of smoke. And the Benjamites looked behind them and saw the entire city was going up in smoke to the heavens. And when the men of Israel turned back, the men of Benjamin were troubled, for they saw that calamity was so close to them. And they turned their backs before the men of Israel toward the way of the wilderness. But the battle overtook them. While those who had come out of the cities were destroying them in their midst, they surrounded the Benjamites and pursued them, and with ease trampled them down as far as the front of Geba toward the east. And there fell of Benjamin 18,000 men. All of these were mighty men.
Mm.
And they turned and fled toward the wilderness to the rock of Rimmon. And they cut down 5,000 of them on the highways and followed them up to Gidom and struck 2,000 of them. Mm. And all who fell of Benjamin that day were 25,000 men who drew the sword. For all these were mighty men. But 600 men turned and fled toward the wilderness to the rock of Rimmon, and they dwelt at the rock of Rimmon for 4 months. Mm. 4 new moons, 4 months. And the men of Israel turned back against the children of Benjamin and struck them with the edge of the sword from every city, men and beasts, all who were found. And they set fire to all the cities that they came to.
Wow. They damn near wiped Benjamin off the map.
Saved 600 men. That's it. Started off, what they say, of the men of battle, about 27,000. They whooped about 25,000 in one city.
And these were no chumps they whooped. They said, you know, these fellas could sling a rock with the slingshot and hit a hair off somebody's head.
And if you notice, it keeps saying men who drew the sword. So we're not talking about innocents.
No.
We're not talking about
warriors.
Yeah.
Stealth elite.
Yeah. Okay.
Shucks.
Hallelujah. So what happens next?
Okay.
12, 13.
Yeah, okay.
Read the whole thing
if you want. All right. And the men of Israel have sworn an oath at Mizpah, saying, not one of us shall give his daughter to Benjamin as a wife. So the people came to Beth-El and sat there until evening before Elohim, mm-hmm. and lifted up their voices and wept bitterly, and said, O Yahuah, Elohim of Israel, why has this come about in Israel, that today there should be one tribe missing in Israel? Mm. And it came to be on the morrow that the people rose early and built a slaughter place there and brought ascending offering and peace offerings.
So now they didn't kill them. Were they sorry because they're about to completely remove one of their own tribes?
But just think about the attitude of the priest.
Yeah.
He said, when they was traveling through the night, he said, let us not go into strangers' town.
Yeah.
Let us go into our people to dwell with our people. But our people, you know, when you think this black on black crime or our inability to get along or to coexist, when you think this just started, it hasn't. You know what I'm saying? Our people, Benjamin felt like a whole nother people instead of one people. Yep. And so what Abiyah tried to do, or not tried to do, what Abiyah is going to do with the 12 tribes, it's a miracle. You know what I'm saying? Them 12 sons who can, he telling us, I want y'all to be one big family.
That's right.
And it's going to happen. Whether you like it or not.
One mind, one body, one flesh, one spirit, one head.
And so you think about those that died, and you think about, even to this day, our inability, our people's inability to get along with each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And you're wondering, like, why so many people die?
Crab in a barrel syndrome.
Hey, you know what I'm saying? Is Yahuah removing people that have the inability to coexist?
You can't overlook that as a possibility. Because Yah knows all. Right? In from the beginning. Y'all have heard the phrase addition by subtraction?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We are such a troubled and disturbed people that we can't all even dwell in a room together for over an hour before somebody have a problem with somebody.
Say the truth.
You know, what is it? What is the psychology behind it? What is wrong with our people that, and I think I figured it out. I got a theory.
Mm-hmm.
Well, at least modern day time.
Yeah.
Our people want to be respected.
Yeah.
Everybody want to be respected. But see, what happens is, we get these self images about ourselves.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And when these images are shattered, meaning like we think we appear a certain way and we think everybody see us this way. You know what I'm saying? Because in our head, you know, we got this whole thing worked out. You know what I mean? And we're psyching the hell out of ourselves. And as soon as, because if anybody going to expose it to you, it's going to be Israel. And as soon as somebody exposed to you, like, you know, we react violent. It's a violent reaction because we can't deal with this reality check.
Yeah.
We can't. What do you mean? I'm not the stuff. Yeah, no, no, we never, no, none of us ever thought, you know what I'm saying?
I would agree. And I think we can all find places where we've been guilty of that.
Mm-hmm. I know I have.
I think what's going to separate us, family, from those who don't make it in the wilderness and those who do is being able to humble ourselves to a degree that we can acknowledge that maybe we need to reassess,
yeah,
regroup,
yeah,
you know, and come back in a more humbled manner. It's part of our worldly experience, walking through the valley of the shadow of death. Mm-hmm. You know, that you brush up against prickly people,
mm-hmm,
and y'all prickly together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we quick to cut people off.
Quick.
Yeah, I ain't dealing.
I ain't got a limit. Or you know, you sitting there, you listening to somebody talk, or you sitting there and you, yeah, you fellowshipping with your family and stuff, and you like this.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, what I'm saying? Ruth, let me tell you something, Hebrews. That's going to be our final test about whether or not we can live as one big tribe. Like Abba Yah said, when he have us all in that desert, let me tell you who ain't going to make it. 99.9% of the Hebrews who cannot coexist with each other, who cannot look at each other as family, because that's what Abba Yah asks us to do. And as you can see, we haven't, you know, the first...
It was something we always had issues.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Getting right, absolutely.
When scripture say he gonna be there in them last days, this entire heart, man, you better know that.
I talked to a brother at the beginning of this week who I just met for the first time. So I was getting ready to say, don't know he an Israelite, but I don't know that because I don't know him.
Mm-hmm.
But we were talking about his venture to try to help somebody,
mm-hmm,
in business, and how this person just kept on complaining instead of receiving the help and the guidance and the counsel in building his business that he was trying to help him with by allowing him to come do business with him.
Mm-hmm.
And he told me, you know what I told him? He said, I'm going to help you. I'm finna help you get your own. And I laughed out loud. Mm-hmm. He said, I'm finna help you get your own because this, me and you together, this is not gonna work.
Mm-hmm.
And he beat me to the sentiment of what I was thinking, which is saying, you know, you don't always have to be an enemy with someone.
Mm-hmm.
Like you can just disassociate so that there's no love lost.
Mm-hmm. Like Abraham and Lot.
Abraham and Lot. You took the words out of my mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what I was thinking as I was saying. It's like Abraham and Lot. So you couldn't deal well together. That's going to happen.
It's gonna happen.
It's unavoidable.
It's gonna happen.
But there's a way to peaceably separate and love someone from afar.
Yes.
Because being, yes, up close together is causing some friction.
Yes. Our personalities clash. Yeah. Or, you know what I'm saying? It's you know, so it's like, you know, it with love in a loving manner, step away.
Right. In a loving manner.
So that when you see each other, yeah, y'all can still fellowship, yeah, y'all can still, you know what I'm saying?
They separated. Abraham still went to go get Lot.
Yeah.
When he heard that they had got Lot in his family.
My nephew,
right,
not my nephew, is going down.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? But that's a gift to be able to do that. And you have to, let me tell you something. When we living in that wilderness, y'all willing, when we, I pray I make it, you know, living in that wilderness, sometimes the problem with you, sometimes you in the funky mood.
Yeah, sometimes you can't see it.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Sometimes we're too close to the situation to see it.
Yep.
Sometimes it takes somebody else being a little bit far off.
Yeah.
And I started to say an elder, but it's not always an elder. Look, yep, at Job.
Mm-hmm.
It was a youth that had to give them righteous perspective,
okay,
on the situation.
Okay. So it really is a humbling. It really is having the ability to question not only, you know, we good at questioning and judging our friends and our family and our loved ones, right, but question and judge yourself. You know what I'm saying? What was behind your action? Like, could you have handled that better? Could you have spoke better? Like, speak to people the way you want people to speak to you. If you don't want nobody talking to you in no funky tone, you know, if you ask somebody a question, if you don't want nobody, what? You know, then don't do that to people. It's real simple. You know what I'm saying? I don't see how hard it is. Speak to people the way you want people to speak to you. Give people the benefit of the doubt the way, which is one I have to work on. Give people the benefit of the doubt. Well, even
speaking to people the way you want, like, yeah, I'm being tired sometimes. Sometimes I'm short.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have to be reminded either by my wife and my children,
yeah,
or my own sometimes, like, you being short. And sometimes when I'm doing good, sometimes I catch myself and I come back and I say, I'm sorry, I'm really tired. You know,
y'all
just give me a minute. I'm tired right now. Just give me a minute.
And in this day and time, people, we really need to practice this. Yeah. Because remember, Yah has taken the love from the earth. The baby, that red horse has been set free.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? That red horse is, you know what I'm saying? And so a lot of these cases, a lot of these deaths, you're dealing with people with nobody had the humbleness to say, I don't care if you're wrong or not. I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry. You know, you nearly ran somebody off the road. They jump out their car, angry, red in the face. Okay, listen, I am so, please forgive me. Can I get your tea or something? You know what I'm saying? Because guess what? But what's happening is they come out with rage. You go, you ain't. And somebody shot dead in that on the news today. Two people shot dead in the road.
Let me give you a funny example of one that I witnessed in person. I think he was in the car with me.
I was
in Chicago riding along with Dan Ryan. And if you know Chicago, you know Chicago traffic. And one of the things that us Chicagoans do is we ride the shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
We ride the shoulder of the road that you're not supposed to drive in.
Yep.
And we cut in front of people
yes.
to be the light. And so yes. like everybody's sitting at the red light, but this shoulder that's for the bus to pull in and for people to get on the bus, if it ain't nobody there, you'll creep that shoulder waiting for the yellow light. And as you see the yellow light on their end, you hurry up and step on the gas.
So
and
you can get in
you're
front.
Trying to time the green so that you can beat them people out, get in front of them, cut in front of them, and you out there first.
Yeah. Ignorant, crazy, going through that.
Ignorant, dangerous. You can hit all kind of wrong. I don't know y'all like that anymore.
Yeah, I used to.
We saw somebody doing that on the opposite side, getting ready to get on the expressway.
Mm-hmm.
And they were kind of jockeying for position. And as this car pulled up, another car zoomed around him, got in front of him at the light. And when he pulled up to that light, the person who he swerved in front of, flung that door open and was finna jump out. Ain't no telling what he was finna do.
Yep.
But this is how fast it happened, fam. And I want y'all to tell somebody who need to hear this.
Yep.
Tell somebody else who needs to hear. By the time that person flung that door open to get out, the person who was in the car in front of them had already anticipating this ignorant Negro.
Yep, sure did.
Had already jumped out, pulled his pistol, and was on him and said, sit the F back down. It was a police officer. It was an unmarked undercover. Yeah. He was being ignorant. I ain't saying he ain't being ignorant.
Yeah.
But had that man had a pistol in his lap, in his hand, anything, you think that police officer wouldn't have emptied 16 in his chest?
He'd been dead.
That man jumped out as he wanted to be.
Well, I'm talking about like it happened so quick. We was like,
he didn't even get a chance to put his foot on the ground. Nope. He flung that door open and was getting ready to get out, and that man had already jumped in and was out. It was on him.
On like, him. You know what I'm saying? And so in this day and time, everybody angry, everybody enraged. It's a spirit moving across the land, taking shalom from the land. If you know this and you understand this, if you know revelations has happened, if you know that seal has been broken, then why would you play into it? Because you're not dealing with flesh and blood.
That's right.
You've been dealing with spirits and principalities. So what's the use of, you know what I'm saying? I'm in a grocery store, you know what I'm saying? Something happened where me and a lady was walking up to the line. And she was walking to the line, and I was walking to the line. And the first thing I'm like, you know, I'm first. But the lady, she did something real ignorant where she just like, damn this, I'm tired of waiting. Like, it just stepped in front of me. So I... And because I did that, you know, and I smiled at her, you know, she stood there the whole time feeling guilt, like her whole movement, like how she felt self-conscious, like she couldn't even, you know, she's standing there, but she's looking back at me like, you know, feeling guilty. And the whole time she stood there like, I wish I never even did this. Now I'm the asshole.
Because you are.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Absolutely.
We got to be able, and this is going to be our test in the wilderness. Okay. This is going to be the test of whether or not we can coexist. We can live together as a family.
All right, picking up. You remember where you left off?
I do not.
It happens. Four?
Is it four? And it came to be on the morrow that the people rose early and built a slaughter place there and brought ascending offering and peace offering. And children of Israel said, who is there among all the tribes of Israel who did not come up with the assembly to Yahuah? And they had made a great oath concerning anyone who had not come up to Yahuah at Mizpah, saying, he shall certainly be put to death. And the children of Israel were sorry for Benjamin, their brother, and said, one tribe is cut off from Israel today. What do we do for wives for those who remain, seeing we have sworn by Yahuah not to give them our daughters as wives?
So real quick, this wasn't even about the men who were there at that time and what they didn't do. This was about Benjamin himself, right? Because if we cut off all of these men, we have now removed Benjamin's name from among the inheritance of Israel. So just because they were all wrong, do we punish Benjamin, is what they're saying. I just want to clarify that. Like, that's a big deal. For them to step back and still remember that this is still family, they were punished.
But, you know,
let's stop here and now reconsider before we move forward and wipe them completely out.
You had a very righteous priest leading the charge.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, he's mentioned once or twice, but you got to know that he was the voice,
right?
You know, right, in their ear.
And
you
he was only saying? Mentioned before they won the battle.
Right.
As being consulted.
Right.
Phineas. He wasn't mentioned before that.
Right.
When they lost those two times.
Right. So that's the high priest at the time. Mm-hmm. So he's definitely leading the charge with this, you know. So, eight. And they said, which one of the tribes of Israel did not come up to Mizpah to Yahuah? And see, no one had come to the camp from Yabesh Gilead to the assembly. Mm-hmm. And when the people called a roll, see, not one of the inhabitants of Yabesh Gilead was there. And the congregation sent out there 12,000 of their bravest men and commanded them, saying, go and you shall strike the inhabitants of Yabesh Gilead with the sword, with the edge of the sword, even the women and the children.
Wow.
And this is what you do. Put under the ban every male and every woman who has known a man by lying with him. And they found among the inhabitants of Yabesh Gilead 400 young maidens who had not known a man, and they brought them to the camp of Shiloh, which is in the land of Canaan.
Mm. So they were in Canaan. So now they've removed all the women who already been with a man or who had husbands, and they've left only maidens and virgins. Remember they said a minute ago, they got 600 men left. What should we do for wives for them? Are we going to completely remove Benjamin as a tribe? Okay, let's see what they do. What was that, 13?
Mm-hmm.
You sure you want to just read that one?
No, go ahead.
Then all the congregation sent and spoke to the children of Benjamin who were at the rock of Ramon and proclaimed peace to them. And Benjamin turned back at that time, and they gave them the women whom they had saved alive of the women of Yabesh Gilead. But even so, even still, in other words, there was not enough for them. And the people were sorry for Benjamin because Yahuah had made a breach in the tribes of Israel. And the elders of the congregation said, what do we do for wives for those who remain? 600 minus 400, mm-hmm, leave 200 men with no wives.
Mm-hmm.
Who remain, since the women have been destroyed out of Benjamin? And they said, there is an inheritance for the survivors of Benjamin, and no tribe is to be destroyed from Israel. But we are unable to give them wives from our daughters, for the children of Israel have sworn an oath saying, cursed be the one who gives a wife to Benjamin. So they said, see, there's a yearly festival of Yahuah in Shiloh, which is north of Bethel, on the east side of the highway that goes up from Bethel to Shechem and south to Lebona. And they commanded the children of Benjamin, saying, go, lie in wait in the vineyards and watch. See, when the daughters of Shiloh come out to perform their dance, then you shall come out from the vineyards, and every man catch a wife for himself from the daughters of Shiloh, and go to the land of Benjamin. And it shall be, when their fathers or their brothers come up to complain, that we shall say to them, favor us with them, because we did not take a wife for any of them in battle. Neither have you given to them, making yourselves guilty of your oath. And the children of Benjamin did so, and took enough wives for their number from those who had danced, whom they called. Then they went and returned to their inheritance, and they rebuilt the cities and dwelt in them. And the children of Israel went from there at that time, each one to his tribe and clan. And they went from there, each one to his inheritance. And in those days, there was no sovereign in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Question, because I think last time we read this, I don't know if it was with you guys, but it was probably with our children. The question was this a right thing to say, just go take one of these girls as they go innocently frolicking during the time of this feast and snatch one of them and make them your wife? Was this a righteous thing? And I think some of the things, and feel free to jump in, Rip, I think some of the things we were discussing was, in my opinion, did y'all hear that? Okay. In my opinion, as a father of daughters, during the time of this feast, I'm watching my daughters.
Yeah.
If I don't want my daughters to be one of them, that we've now agreed that these 200, and although they family, if we're not going the traditional route of me giving my daughter and us entering into a mutual agreement, I'm keeping an eye on my daughters. No, your brother's going to escort you, or your father's going to escort you, because I'm not just getting. So now when these men caught these girls that were unattended, that's one aspect of that, in my opinion. You want to add anything else to that?
Yes. Okay. So first of all, understand, like, although we're reading this as if this is coming from the people, remember, this is coming from a selected few, the right. Councilmen.
Right, right.
Almost, you know, they almost like a secret society. Almost. I mean, because they so high up rankings, they're the authorities. So there wasn't a lot of people in this meeting. There were just a few. And when they went to speak to the head of whoever was heading up the Benjamites, hired the 600, you know, when they pulled the head of whoever the leader was into that private meeting and told him the plan, it was a thing in which they had to do something or the line of Benjamin was going to die.
Right.
And I don't think you could just pray and just, you know, have, because, like, think about when we all fellowshipped in Virginia. You know what I'm saying? None of us was watching our children. You know what I'm saying? Because it was beautiful. Like, we felt like, you know what I'm saying, everybody there was family, and it was safe.
Felt like family.
Yeah. And so that's why the head of this branch picked this destination, because they said they're going to be at ease.
That's one aspect.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? They're going to be at ease. And, you know, you'll be able to just, you know. And
in all honesty, you will be among family.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? And so, but y'all willing, you know, once you snatch the daughter and the council said, well, they're going to explain to you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Y'all willing, you know, as a father, you say, well, can I go see my child? Can I now work out, since the deed is done, can I now work out some arrangements? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Can we, you know, and y'all willing is merciful, you know, that was loud.
Yeah, and again, like Rev said about some of the other stuff we read, they don't go into a lot of detail, but the prayer is that when they say grab a girl, kiss a girl, whatever that game was, just play as a child. Yahweh, and once they grabbed them, they then entered into a covenant with them, and then they did
meet
the father.
Yeah, you know.
So we don't read those details, but in a righteous setting, That would be what happened.
Because how else could Benjamin rebuild if not by being able to take advantage of the in-laws, whatever the in-laws could offer and could bring, you know what I'm saying? Because a marriage, you know, back in those days, marriage wasn't just, you know, I meet you, we fall in love.
Right.
You know, marriage is with power arrangements, you know what I'm saying? I'm in the business of making soap and I need you to take the wife of the business of the man who make labels.
Yeah.
You know, now I got labels for myself. You know what I'm saying? It was Power Rangers.
And then, and the other aspect to add to that was also that, remember, they had taken an oath not to give their daughters.
Right.
So now what they've done in this instance is they've relieved themselves of the burden of being mm-hmm. guilty of the oath by being able to say, even if I was okay with my daughter marrying one of them,
yeah,
I would be breaking the oath if I gave.
But if you
caught them and y'all wound up getting married,
yeah.
I didn't actually give them
to you, right?
And
right.
so I believe yeah. that in the way we read it, that some of these they were okay with them marrying the Benjamites.
Yeah,
they just did not want to be guilty of breaking the oath,
right?
And right. so this was how they got around that,
right? Yeah.
That's my perspective.
Yeah.
So
I wanted to add it one more thing.
Go ahead.
To open
up the mic.
When I was saying, you know, how best we can, things that we can do to kind of practice getting along better as a people. I wanted to add one more thing because we can also try to make ourselves more likable. You know what I mean? You know
what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying? That's all a part
that's,
of
that's how y'all do. You're looking for
no, trying to change. No, I ain't trying to change, baby. All I'm saying is, in a part of that humbling,
yeah.
is you know what I'm saying? There are certain personality traits that you know, because I know America teaches us, like, if you ain't got no haters, then you ain't doing good, you know what I'm saying? So you got to get out there and get, you know, I'm doing me,
If you ain't got no haters,
feel free to hate on me. You know what I'm saying? But like, look at this. Look what I'm doing. You know what I'm saying? Look at the spirit of this.
Yeah.
Look. You know what I'm saying? This is a very selfish.
What does scripture say about that? About the women of Israel elongating their necks.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's not the kind of
And men do that too.
Yeah. But that's not the kind of spirit, lovable spirit. You know what I'm saying? Like, who's got, like, if you spend your days lording yourself, you know what I'm saying, over us, like, okay, so you could sing. And so all day long, you, I asked you what a serp was. I didn't ask you, the serp is in the cap. You know, come on. I did. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, those are the kind of things that cause, especially in Israel, you know what I'm saying? And so, you know, in this bid or in this quest to be able to survive what's coming, to be able to survive living in the wilderness, because so many of us are not going to make it out of the wilderness. So many of us are not going to be able to cross over because we can't humble ourselves. So understanding each other and trying to talk better and you know, to each other, to add to that, try to make yourself more likable, humble yourself,
peaceful,
and try to
exercise
peaceable, be kind,
patient,
you know what I'm saying,
humble,
be an ear to listen, slow to speak, quick to listen.
Yeah.
Sometimes people, you know, your brother, sister may be having a bad day, and maybe, you know, if you see your brother, sister acting out, all they need is for you to grab them and hug them. I love you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, just, we've so quick to be riled up. And just in this day and time, if you quick to be riled up, then that red spirit on you too.
Yeah.
The spirit of that horse on you too. And you doomed anyway. And it's only a matter of time. Tick tock, you got.
And you got to remember that the adversary is an expert at casting that line out with the bait that is most successful. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And pride is one of them.
Yeah.
Envy is one of them.
Yeah.
Lust is one of them. Vanity, big one.
Yeah. To prevent a fight, sometimes you got to apologize, even if you don't think you've been wrong.
Yeah. But so, we got to remember that we, and this is the biggest detriment, in my opinion, to us as a nation. We have to remember that we are brothers and sisters, because we still, I believe, as a people, most of us still, I'm not talking about the few that understand it. I believe that most of us still view each other as separate, whereas every other nation in the world understands that their nation is their family.
Yeah.
And they band together to protect their nation, right or wrong. Like, let me correct mine. I don't need you to correct them. Mm-hmm. I'll correct them privately.
Mm-hmm.
Publicly, step back. I'll correct them.
Yeah.
Right? We bash each other in public. We bash each other behind the scenes, you know, all that. So if we could just remember that we are brothers and sisters, and another aspect of that is meaning as brothers and sisters, that's not a brother up there.
No.
You're right?
No.
And we're not brothers if I got to look down here.
Yeah, if I got to step on you.
We all servants.
Yeah.
Of the Most High God. We're supposed to be serving each other.
Remember
and
that.
We're supposed to be serving those who are eager to learn.
Dang.
And so to come in, you know, again, as Rip said, lording ourselves, you know, I know more than you. I'm older than you. I've been in this longer than you. Mm-hmm. You know, it's more ways than we can list
mm-hmm.
of ways to divide and conquer. But that's a Willie Lynchism.
That is.
Just think about it. You know, we separate each other based on, you know, what side of the pond you live on.
Yeah.
Whether or not you can speak Hebrew fluently, or not.
Yeah,
or how you pronounce,
or how well you know the Bible, or how you know,
yeah, all that, as opposed to dealing with each other in humility, wherever you came in and is where you mm-hmm. came in. Yet, if you come in eagerly
mm-hmm.
trying to learn, listen, that's where you at. That's where mm-hmm. you at. Let's deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
Let's deal with it and be patient. And you know, everybody ripens in their own season. And when it's time, according to Yah, for them to write it. And so,
one of the things I could say I am proud of about me and Shlomo and our walk and our ministry is a lot of people who we talk to and deal with, they have no clue, like, how long we've been studying the scriptures. Because when we talk to them, you know, our goal ain't, I don't need to belittle you to feel big. You know what I'm saying? So we don't need to make you feel the shame in order to feel better about ourselves. Mm-hmm. So our goal, when we come in, we understanding that this is a fight for a soul.
Right.
And so sometimes what's required is for you to sit and listen and maybe even be amazed at some of the things they're saying. It don't matter that you
know that already.
Right. You know what I'm saying? It don't matter that, you know, they speak in kindergarten like it's amazing and you in, you know, fifth and sixth grade. It don't matter. Sometimes you just be amazed with them. Like, yeah, and that's so, yeah.
And sometimes,
you know,
empathy is just that. You know, The fact that you are excited about what you learned,
yeah.
Let's be excited with you.
Let's be excited with you. I am
excited that you just learned.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. That's a like, person in the fight with us.
Do that, girl, please. You know, yeah. Because now you belittling them, you making them feel like you're taking away from their celebration.
Yeah.
This was something they just discovered. You know what I'm saying? And then, you know, but that being said, sometimes, you know, you do have to correct.
Yeah.
Or just,
but
there's a way to do it.
Yeah.
There's a way in love to just be like, no, sis, or no, bruh.
Not
you know
quite.
What I'm saying?
Not
quite. But I mean, you own something, but just, you know, when you see that they may, you know what I'm saying? And so there is a balance to it, but there's a way to do it in love.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? And you have to, it's a humbling on both ends. You know what I'm saying? It's, but this is how we got to deal with each other. We have to learn how to be okay sometime saying wow when you already knew. And
take a back seat sometimes.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? And just let somebody else shine. You know what I'm saying? You gotta be okay with, because everybody wanna feel loved. Everybody wanna feel special.
Yeah.
Everybody wanna feel like they're needed and wanted and they're shining through. Everybody wanna feel like that.
And you are.
Yeah.
You
are, and yeah.
And
you know what I'm saying?
We are. We are a royal people.
We are.
We are a royal priesthood, right? So we are all supposed to feel that way.
Yeah.
And so let's get all of us on that same playing field where we can, as a nation, say, again, we are a royal people and the apple of his eye.
Understanding that there's one head. You know, the Messiah is our head.
Okay.
To Abba Yah, let all the steam go.
Okay.
So if I said something that got through, then hallelujah, because it was Yah's will.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? And so if we can remember that, we'd be okay. We'd be okay.
And that's why you will hear a lot of times as we closing out with, you know, the studies that we do that are pre-recorded stuff, you know, we often like to close out with, if there was any understanding, there was gain, let all esteem be to Yahuah Bahashem, Yahusha HaMashiach. Now, that is not only giving Yah his esteem and his proper due esteem and Yahusha his due esteem, but it's also an act of consciously humbling ourselves and putting ourselves in the position that we are supposed to be in, which is we are not bigger or greater than this collective body.
Nope.
And each of us have the ability to add to and build up this body.
Absolutely.
We're just doing our little part.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Maybe we just a little toenail on the body.
Okay.
Maybe we that hangnail on the toenail on the body. It don't matter. I just want to play my part because I want to be a part of the body. I don't care what piece I am. I just want to be a part of the body. And that being said, oftentimes we have to check spirits on ourselves because it's real easy to be like, you know, it's not easy to sit and listen to somebody say something you already know. Yeah. It's not, your first response is going to want to be like, I know, you know what I'm saying? It's not easy.
Let's look at that as routine maintenance. Like,
yeah.
We're all familiar with the concept of self-care and say self-maintenance, because in this new, I'm gonna use it, in this new woke era,
you can't say woke.
Mental health is out front.
Yeah, it is.
And so we're familiar with this idea of self-care and self-maintenance, and all I'm saying is, to tie into what you're saying, let self-examination be part of our self-care, right? And you will find yourself in a better mental state if you are taking care of examining self and correcting and fine-tuning the things we need to fine-tune.
Yes. Yes, because I don't care who you are. You struggle. I struggle with vanity.
Mm-hmm.
I struggle with that because, you know, why did you even dip in the room? I struggle with vanity because, you know, Abba Yah has blessed me with a good head on my shoulders, kind of smart a little bit, you know what I'm saying? So it's easy to be like, sit down, dummy. We all know, you know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? But that's our wickedness. That's the voice of Belial. You know what I'm saying? And in the mission and in my determination to be able to coexist with my people, I gotta check demons on me.
Because all have to check.
You know?
Yeah.
Demons like, they like to puff you up. They like to puff you up. They like to blow your head up. They like to whisper. You know, they like to, you know, what Al Pacino said in the movie.
It's my favorite saying.
Vanity is my favorite saying. The devil could do so much through vanity, puffing you up. Oh, you so special.
Tried and true.
Man, you so special. You so smart. With these scriptures, you an oracle. Abraham ain't got nothing on you.
Family, we're going to open it up if y'all want to come to the mic. But I'm going to ask y'all, because we weren't recording and some of y'all weren't in the room, as we give a disclaimer about our background. We are making some changes to kind of reorganize our production and make it a little bit more conducive with our living space.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to see a couple of a couple of times that we come on the mic where you're going to see a couple of different looks. We're just trying to find what works.
This is the one I picked. I like it. I think, you know, because I'm all into the, you know, the feng shui.
I like it too. I just wanted to work with the house so that we don't, what y'all don't know, unless y'all been here in the time that we record, is every time we record, we have to make a big change in the house pre-recording and after recording. And then again, on the Shabbos, when I did the recording, it's a whole different change in the house. And so the scale, you know, scaling up and getting all the children to help to move furniture and get all this in place, it's an ordeal. And our lives are so busy that we stuck between the rock and the hard place.
We are.
It's so busy that we need to fine-tune it so that we can just sit down and record by just setting up the camera and the lights.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not at a point where we can afford
a studio.
Yeah, or put together a separate studio.
Or a separate room where we
can just say this is just for recording. So
my son was like, yeah, Mom, you know, the parents, you know, you should get you a shed and turn it into a studio. I'm like, wouldn't that be nice?
It would be nice if we could add electricity.
You know what I'm saying?
Air condition, you know, under the 10-degree weather.
And heat.
When in the damn 30-degree weather.
Yeah. She said, it's coming. Hey, hallelujah, sis. Hallelujah.
Yeah, I'm willing.
Yeah.
We're going to keep doing what we can. Like I said, and I've said this from the beginning. Listen, look along the bottom of the screen. You're going to see our Cash App scroll. If you want to donate. No, I'm joking. What I said from the beginning is I would never do that. And so, you know, although our production may not be.
I almost spit my tea on your computer.
We're not drinking tea. No, I said from the beginning, it's like if Yah wants us to do this.
See, that's what I was going to say.
Yah will provide for us to do this. So, and so it may not be the best production y'all see, but our heart is in it. Our attentions, we believe, are righteous.
That's my knowledge, raised y'all better. What's the difference to be drinking tea, son?
And if I can afford to upgrade, we upgrade. And if we can't afford to upgrade, we do what we can.
Yeah.
So we're in another transition.
I did try, sis. I did. I tried.
Okay. All right, family. Okay. So again, I'm gonna reiterate. I recorded the studying seeking a priesthood part 16 before we came on to do this. And so I'm gonna offer a short window. If I see hands go up, we're gonna let y'all come to the mic. If I don't, we're gonna close out.
Dang.
Because that's two in a row for me.
Yeah.
But feel free, come to the mic. If you guys got testimonies, you want to share something, you got questions.
You want to sing a song? Who can sing? Somebody can
you
sing?
You want to sing a song? Feel free. If you can sing.
No, I'm telling you, because you know. Admittedly.
If you got a piece of poetry you want to share, absolutely. It's all good, fam.
It's all steam, I'll be out.
Okay.
Okay.
Come to Natasha. Anybody? Nobody? No.
Not right.
Come on, now, sis.
That's not nice.
That isn't
look,
nice.
No, look.
He's an ass. I told you guys. You guys believe me. But you're starting to see it a little bit.
Let me say, sis, with all love, I do the same thing to Andy.
I know.
I do the same thing.
That's why I be telling y'all he is a jerk. Y'all do not believe me.
And I just was. Yeah, but I just was on your side earlier when you said she liked to push the buttons.
Mm-hmm. She was on his side.
No, but she literally said,
see what I'm dealing with. He's like that all the time with us. You know, he
let
just
me tell you something. If I wasn't the way I am, I would have crumbled and withered away a long
time. Oh, what you crumbled and withered away. It's a blessing to
let
be
me
married.
Say. Let me say this: you Israelite cultees are very strong.
Hey, somebody was like, it takes Chicago men to date Chicago women.
Yes, it does.
He talking about these beasts ain't for nobody else. That's what he said. He said, them beasts ain't for nobody else but Chicago
men. But it's something, too, and I'm going to get serious for a second. Cole, you steal your mic, though. It's something to be said about the things that these brothers are doing and saying about our Israelite women. and preferring to pretty much just deal with any and everybody else but their own women because they can't deal with Israelite women. And in my opinion, it's a reflection on them, not a reflection on their coaties. Y'all made Israel strong. Y'all made Israelite women strong. You, brother, are supposed to be strong enough to deal with your Israelite woman. Deal with that woman. Lead her, guide her, teach her, allow her to blossom, and do what she's supposed to do.
Hey, Cub, you got to check.
If you got to say,
sometimes
you sit down and be quiet for a minute, have the fortitude to say, I'm going to need you to sit down and relax for a minute.
Hey, you got to do this. You got
to
do this. Because
you do have to do that sometimes. But there's also a passionate and loving way to do that. And also a way that lets her know, I'm serious. I'm right now.
Woman.
There's no woman. Gray area. I mean, now.
Let me tell you something. My Ish has done it to me several times. Negro eyes went red on me. Thank you, baby. Negro eyes.
Passionate and loving.
Passionate. My foot. Negro eyes went red on me. And that Negro say, I said, oh, brother, I heard it. I'm right here. I'm two steps ahead of you. Go
passionate and love. The Coty Latasha, let's move on. What you got, sis?
No, I was going to say, I wanted to put out there that myself, Coty Gabora, and Coty Kimmy, we created a Coty chat room where we all can come together on Zoom. So, you know, I love my Coty hour. And me and Coty Gabor was talking about it. So we had created a Coty chat room where we all can come together on Zoom and we could just have different discussions as far as, like, you know, everything. Like you said, Israelite women, different topics. Like I was telling her, I wanted to do Hot Topic Sundays with, like, the women of the Bible. Mm-hmm. And we could talk about that and how it relates to us of today. So we want to try to launch it tomorrow. So I was going to send a link out to our group chat. So if anybody want to log in and join, please feel free.
Hallelujah.
That's good. Excellent. Congratulations.
I have a question for you about it. Is there an
answer
for those who are able to enter?
Yeah. Is it like for
the young? Yes. So it's for, well, we're going to start off the trial with our 17, or is it, how many of us in that group chat? With us in the group chat, but it is, I did do like a different list for each day, because I do want to do one where it's just for like the teens, like mothers and daughters.
Okay.
So we can have something for them, because, you know, most of us in here have daughters as well as sons, but I want to do something with just mothers and daughters for a day of just that, where we talk to them and we ask them their certain opinions about growing up now and the truth and stuff like that. So we do have, like on Wednesdays, we're going to do like a prayer day, where if you need prayer, if you want to have a conversation. So I do have a list, but I want to do a trial run with just our group of people. Okay.
Hallelujah. I think that's an excellent idea.
Just promise me you all are gonna try to get along.
Yeah.
No matter, let's use all these different groups and different gatherings as practice.
Yeah.
So you know what I'm saying?
And also I think it's an excellent opportunity to practice something that Shaul Paul spoke about, which is dealing with the elder. The Coties being guides mm-hmm. and wise counselors for the young Coties. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to do the same thing with the brothers. You know, I think that's an excellent idea. Mentally, when you get after a Coty, Antoinette, can you put your hand up and come to the mic and share with us your plans for the YouTube channel that you and I just started as well, please?
Oh, yeah, that's going to be good.
Since we're on that topic. Mm-hmm. A Coty, Antoinette?
Was the Coty Tatasha finished? She was finished?
I don't know. Were you done, Coty?
I just wanted to.
Oh, yeah. Yep, I'm done.
Okay. Hallelujah. I think that's great. Excellent.
That is great.
Coty Antoinette?
I just wanted to say that Yah is my shepherd. Yeah. I shall not lack. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures.
All right, that's it.
Hey, hallelujah. Hey. You can hold a note, Cole.
That's right.
Oh, my goodness.
It. I like it. So now we're going to have to open up. We're going to have to open up with a selection with a selection of music from someone.
I knew with all these Hebrew women in there, we had to have some singers. Y'all, you know what I'm saying? Back. We had to. I knew it.
I know a brother that opened up with a selection of him and his wife who was watching their videos.
Yeah, he played what is that called?
Guitar.
Is that a guitar? That's not like that. Okay, anyway, go ahead, Middle League baby.
Hey, Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Okay, so me and Naya, we started a YouTube channel. We're going to send a link into the big group chat. It's called What's Brewing? And we want to make that YouTube channel kind of targeting Hebrews in our age. So, like, you know, young adults, teens. So the videos that we plan on doing, it's not going to be, like, so, like, lesson-based. You know, it's not going to be like less space. It's going to be almost like podcast. We're just going to be sitting down and we're going to be talking, mostly reacting to other vehicle videos. Oh, I said vehicles. Mostly reacting to other videos. And so, like one video that really sparked the idea, though, we were watching the AMP video and it was almost said it again. It was called Find a Racist. It was an AMP video.
What's the AMP?
Yeah.
AMP, yeah, you know, we old, baby.
The group of YouTubers in our generation. It's a really cool group of YouTubers. A lot of people watch them, you know, a bunch of young black cats, and they doing good. You know, they're streamers and they make YouTube videos. But they made this one called Find the Racist. And we were actually watching it with a group of friends. So we all spotted the racist before the video was over. And then when the racist got to talking, they were like, so you call yourself racist? He was like, no, I don't call myself that. But with the morals and the ideals that I hold, other people will consider me that, you know? And so they were talking and he was like, you know, explaining the things that he agreed with, like, you know, segregation. I was like, you know, we was like, I was talking to the group of people. I was like, you know, y'all may look at us funny or me funny, but I agree with everything he said. He didn't say anything wrong at this point, you know.
Yeah.
Those would be interesting conversations.
Those will be.
I'll see those videos. Yeah. I think those that's good. And so. I think that it's a beautiful thing to see people of y'all age group take the mantle and continue to push, because it is so needed. Like,
it is.
You know, it's a lot of people our age doing videos. Mm-hmm. It's not a lot of people y'all age in the truth doing videos that are bait and food to lure more people into the truth.
Okay.
So however you do it, however y'all puts it on your heart to do it, like with mine, with her writing, whatever it is, because the foundation is what it is, people begin to see it. They feel it sprinkled in, and then scripture says, my sheep hear my voice.
Yeah.
And so if they're being called through what y'all are doing, they're going to ask more questions.
And you really see where the Messiah gave his taught ones different baits.
Yeah.
They all didn't have the same bait. And so there's a lot of people, a lot of brews even, that may not agree with my stories because, maybe in their opinion, the stories get too graphic, you know, it's too much hood stuff happening, you know, a lot of violence, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, it's the bait that I feel like the Most High gave me. And, you know what I'm saying? There are a lot of people who have come searching for Yah by hearing.
Yeah.
You know,
and we got to get out of our own way. Like, we presume, and this is the bait that me and Rib have, it's a loving, peaceful debate that we have all the time about feeling like everybody should do something the way you do. So I was raised different than Rib was raised. We're not going to think the same way about everything. We're not going to have the same view on everything. We're not going to have the same process or way of doing things about everything. And so, we have to understand that there were different classes even among righteous Israel.
Mm-hmm.
there were different classes in a different way than we look at classism now. So not looking down on people, but there were people who were very well off. There was a ruling class. Remember, Israel was an aristocracy. Mm-hmm. It was not a democracy. It was an aristocracy. And so there was a ruling class, a ruling family. And yes, they were lifted up. But at the same time, depending on what you had, that was where you were among the people. Mm-hmm. If it wasn't so, Torah wouldn't have told us, if you couldn't afford to bring this animal for your tithes and offering, bring this animal. If you couldn't afford the cattle or the bull or whatever, then you bring a dove.
Yeah.
Then you bring a whatever. And so, yeah, we have to keep that in mind and understand that everybody that Yah puts on their heart to use their gift to lure people into the truth, mm-hmm. he's putting people in positions among several different thought processes, mindsets. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to find the right way to say that. Because he wants all his people.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? He wants all his people.
There. Even your generation, man. Like, even generation Z, you know, the generation of people say gone. You know what I'm saying?
Say what?
They say they go. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? If Abba Yah is putting on your heart to communicate with them in the way that, because a lot of times you talk to mom and I really don't understand what you be saying. You know, I nod, I be like, but in my head, I be thinking, I don't know what he just said to me. You know what I'm saying? But
say it like something has been around for years. It's the AMG people.
Right, the AMG people.
You say AMG, I'm thinking Mercedes.
What? I'm thinking the group, AMG. Yeah. You know, I'm like, really? They doing videos now? You know what I'm saying? So it's like, we're old.
They still around?
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So if Abba Yah is putting on you and I your heart to be able to communicate with your generation,
right?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Because somebody...
We're trying, but we're not succeeding.
Yeah. There's a... You know what I'm saying? That, you know, I be talking to some of the people in your generation, boy, and it just be like,
okay, hallelujah. So maybe Tyler might enjoy that channel then because she understands what they're talking about.
Tyler knew.
I had no idea.
What AMG was. Like, I'm completely lost. And he said it like, he said it like everybody should know it. And I'm just like,
yeah.
And that's how it is most of the time when I'm talking to him. You know what I'm saying? And
it's you. The car just drove last week.
Yeah, I'm thinking about the group. Did you know?
They so
wicked. AMG? You know,
anybody else want to come to the mic? Good. I think that's great.
Yes.
I think both the group for the Cotees, I think it's needed. Yeah. And I think that's excellent. And that channel, I think is needed. And I think that's excellent. Absolutely.
Let us know when you roll it out. Send out a link and we will pass it forward.
Anaya.
Good job, mama. Good job.
I want to
see you.
I want to say, Menelik, I'm excited about your
who is that?
Your channel, you and I.
Who's on the mic?
Because
you know that.
Because I think I have an idea that you all should talk about gaming and how it's destroying.
Oh, okay.
Their mindset. You know, like that would be great. You know, and to focus on, you know, maybe just a little bit younger than you, because some people think that gaming is everything.
Gaming.
And so I think that's
real team mentally gamer. Mentally games.
Okay. No, yep. No. No, that's a lie.
Yes.
No, some of my students are missing homework assignments because gaming has become their life.
Like that. Nah, he don't game like that.
Yeah, so sometimes they game too much, or they like them shrooms. They love the shrooms. They think they're everything. Yeah, so I have a lot of shrooms. So it definitely
like psychedelic mushrooms. I will.
Yeah, they like they on those
children
shrooms.
Do that.
Students. You talking about the students' age, right?
That's like designer drugs.
No, like, you know what I'm talking about. They're
I thought you had to have money to do that.
Menelik,
you
know what I'm talking about.
That's like the
70s. I know.
Yeah.
Wow.
They're doing shrimp. Menelik know exactly what I'm talking about. So, you know, it's a lot of content that I can collect data for you in my office, out of my office.
Are they doing the shrooms up there?
Data ideas.
They doing the shrooms.
Yeah, they doing shrooms, they doing acids. Like you'll be seeing a lot of the fair skin folk over here. They'll stick their tongue out and there'll be like a little singe mark on their tongue. That's because they just got finished from letting the acid burn off their tongue.
Kelsey, yeah. Are you right? I think that's a good topic.
Well, there you go.
I'll be honest with me, I was always scared of that. I thought to myself, I don't have 3 days. Man. I don't have days to lose.
You got stuff to do.
I can't be and that was the way I was raised, again, different from the way Red was raised, because I went to school with the children of a lot of different nationalities. I had access to all that stuff, and I was just like, I'm scared of that. I can't afford to be tripping for 3 days and being on the L on the way home and fall off.
Oh, no. Third rail. No.
I was just scared to try. I can't do it.
I must be real old school. Like, we, you know, it was a little reefer smoke, but that's about it. You know, it's a little reefer. You know, everybody smoked a little reefer. You know what I mean? Smoked a little reefer.
Coach, I think that's a good topic.
That's just a few that I have ideas about. But, you know, there are different types of. I know y'all over there on Utopia, on 5 acres of land of Utopia over there. But I'm just saying, that's a whole nother little mean world.
No.
That's a whole nother little mean world.
There is an aspect to where we at in our life that we have to double back and realize that Yah has completely removed us from a lot of stuff.
Yes.
We don't see and touch a lot of things that a lot of people do. The whole COVID thing. When COVID happened, you know how much of COVID affected us?
Like, we don't even come in contact with people. COVID, you know what I'm saying?
Affected us at all.
Yeah.
Because the things that people had to stop doing because of COVID, we were already not doing. We were already removed from everything. So I take your point. You're 100% right.
Yeah.
Mentally.
Yeah, some of us out there in the churches.
I think that if you could set up a think about Menelik and Anaya, and maybe Koti Latasha too, if y'all could come up with a way for people to submit suggestions to you for topics
or videos for y'all to respond
and videos
to.
And stuff like that for the group chat for the Koti's and for y'all channel. Mm. I think that's a good idea. Because I think people have good ideas that they can, and then you can parse through them and see what you want to tackle and what you don't.
Because, and then maybe y'all can even come in contact with that. What's that girl name? She the truth. What's her name? She popular. What's her YouTube channel? Yaitzy? Yami? The little young girl that do the reaction videos. She the truth. Light skin, yeah.
Okay.
You know what I'm talking about, man? Like, you know, maybe y'all could even partner up. But I think that's because she, you know, people send her videos and they get her from a Hebraic perspective, your response to these videos, you know.
I like that idea.
Yeah. I got a video I like y'all to respond to. Let me know when you accept entries.
I like to respond to a lot of them. But
you say you accept the entries?
That we don't take requests.
Oh,
okay. Coach Latasha?
See, I start to call you something, sir. So glad we.
I was still laughing after he said that. You don't take requests. I was going to ask Colty Colleen, what is the drug that was inside the school? They had put it inside the juice and they was passing it around to the kids.
What?
And a couple. Yeah, because it was a, I can't remember the name of it. It was, they put somebody, they got a bottle of soda and they poured it in there. And like 3 of the kids passed away. It was elementary kids. And they poured it inside the soda in the lunchroom.
When was it? And they
was passing the soda around. I can't remember the name of it.
Rohizma?
Did you say Rohizma?
Izma. A date rape drug?
The date rape drug?
I want to say, I don't know, but I know it was 12 kids in the lunchroom during lunch, and 3 of them passed away, 12 years old.
Oh, that's so wicked.
Wow.
Oh, that's so wicked.
One of the kids
I know in the schools, they're bringing the edibles. The kids are eating the edibles. I mean, it's just a lot of stuff going on right now. Wow. And so, you know, just tell your children don't take any candy, nothing from anybody. You cannot eat anything from anyone.
Yeah, because a kindergartner overdosed. They she took her mom Sour Patch, because you know they have this the candy like wrappers, and they took this. He took this, and he overdosed on them because he thought it was candy.
Now here's the interesting thing to me, and I know y'all not taking requests, and I am in the league.
He'll take a request.
But here's the interesting thing to me: we are at a point in society where society is telling you that these things are okay. So marijuana is being decriminalized, which means edibles are okay, as long as your job is saying it's okay. Treat it like alcohol. Mm-hmm. Opioids are being classified as something that people who have mental issues or mental health issues, whatever, are succumbing to. So it's a mental health issue as opposed to in our day when it was just, you know, send them crackheads to jail, whatever, blah, blah. As the world begins to tell you things are okay, that according to Torah, we don't read it's okay. How do young adults, I started to say children, how do young adults parse through what the world is telling you? Nah, it's all good. It's no problem. I know we used to say weed was a gateway drug. Nah, cigarettes are more gateway. Alcohol is more gateway. Pharmaceuticals are more gateway. Marijuana, not really a big deal. We decriminalize it. If you want to do it, it's okay. Like, how do young adults begin to parse through all of that and discern righteously whether or not just because the government or society is telling you it's okay, and you could take the same approach with premarital sex and anything of those categories. What the world said is okay, righteously, is it okay? Or should we still be standing firm in something else? For y'all generation, I'm just curious. Like, I don't even want to be part of the conversation necessarily. I'm curious to know where the next generation's head is at, because Whitney Houston said children are our future, and I agree.
Millie, well, that's a good question for you, son. How do you, you know, being there on campus, amongst, you know, peers, I hear you're a pretty popular fella. How do you stand firm in the fact that, like, you keep the Shabbat, you know what I'm saying? How, like, what's your strategy? How do you do it?
And it's a narrow path, sis.
Did he hang up? Oh, we probably lost him. Oh, he gone.
Well, let me answer that question in a way that I've seen for the last 18 years with students who want to stand firm on just what they first call right.
Can you tell them your credentials so they'll know, right, like, where you speak from? For those who don't know you.
I'm sorry. Okay, I work at university and I'm the director of Student Counseling and Wellness Resource Center. I'm a licensed marriage and family therapist. Which is a misnomer. It's a mental health professional that basically any type of diagnosis, I deal with mental health completely, holistically. Mm-hmm. So as a director, basically on campus, we see all types of students, whether it is with mental health disorders, personality disorders, just plain just decision making, anger, just anything you can imagine. And we also do a lot of consulting with the faculty, staff, and I do tons of presentations with my faculty, with the staff, with my staff and with the faculty. And so we're just all over the over the university, just basically trying to address the issues that the students maybe having, or the campus, maybe having the whole campus community. And so with that being said, a lot of times students will come in and they'll give me an education on what's out there, what's prevalent now, and what they're dealing with. So and one of the things that's huge, like you said, like they minimize, you know, marijuana. They've minimized opiates use, so it's not a big deal. You know, everybody's doing it. You know, shrooms help me to sleep better, you know, and so they've minimized all these things. And so my goal is, after the fourth session, if I'm seeing a student or if I'm seeing a client, that you should be able to at least hit a target so we can see, like, well, what can you do to make that better? And then that's when we have this thing where I say, well, let's self-disclose. And so I've been in school before. I've been a college student. Mm-hmm. And even though at the time I was Christian, but as a Christian, that held me fast. It held me. I was strong as a Christian. Mm-hmm. And so my heart was right. It led me to the truth. And as I have come into the truth,
I think that's a big statement.
That has been
a lot of people say, I know my heart. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No. Go ahead. Go ahead and speak more to that.
No. I was just saying that's a big thing, because within the context of what you're saying, you said I was a Christian, but my heart was right, and it led me to the truth. A lot of people say,
right,
y'all know my heart, in order to stay in wickedness.
To stay put.
But you're saying I was a Christian, but my heart was right, and it held me. Mm-hmm. And I was truth and righteousness, and it led me to what I needed to know to move past.
Right, because I don't even trust my heart today, and I'm in the truth. Right, yeah. I mean, I don't trust my heart today. I'm in the truth. That is not something that I would ever, you know. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, so what I do is, my students, I tell them, I said, now I could mess with your head and come off with you with a whole bunch of, you know, theories that I've learned. And the techniques I still use, I said, because I've become skilled as a therapist, I know how to get to the bottom of what your issue is. I said, but what has worked in the past for many of the students that I've seen throughout the years is the truth. Mm-hmm. And I said, I can't teach you the truth. I can't begin to just tell you everything that's in that word, but I promise you, it's your history. Mm-hmm. I said, because the biggest problem that we have today is that we don't know who we are. Mm-hmm. And I said, but I'm going to tell you, you need to really seek out the truth. And I said, and it's in a history book that has been before your eyes all your life, and you didn't even know it was there. Okay. And they begin to ask questions, and then many of them become literally curious about it. And they want to know the truth. But at the end of the day, we can come up with all kind of ideas of what we can say. But like I tell them all the time, I say, you got to know the truth. You got to be true to yourself and true to your creator. Mm-hmm. You got to be true to who made you. And so, you know, they keep coming back. By the time they leave there, it's a whole different story. It's a whole different life. And right. Then the thing that I want to address is something you said was, you're like, what's keeping them from coming? And that's the thing. That's the thing. So if you got a boyfriend or a girlfriend that is quote unquote Christian or, you know, got this nasty ruhab good. I mean, if they, especially, because it's something that is needed. It's something that I think that, you know, people are trying to find answers, and this is the time, because everybody want to be quote unquote the W word, you know, it's out there. We want to be, I'm not going to say that word because Ruby said we could say that word, but anyway,
I'd be picking at him.
Everybody want to be the W.
Well,
I know, but anyway, so they,
I think that's, think that, also, you know, in line with the conversation we were having earlier, as far as everybody having a talent, mm-hmm. Pun intended, And the parable speaking of, you know, I reap where I did not sow.
Okay.
And having the particular bait that is for mm-hmm. whoever y'all trying to reach. I say big up to y'all. You know, what we're doing is one thing. You being there at an HBCU, yes. doing what you're doing,
yes.
and knowing what you know, you yeah. are there. I believe I would have to assume that Yah has placed you there and grown you to where you're at to be
yeah.
a servant for those of his in that next coming generation
yeah.
who need someone to guide them. And you haven't, as long as we've known you, you've been really out front with saying, I'm openly telling them
about the history.
Like with no fear of yeah. the school getting rid of you and saying, you yeah, can't do that, yeah, you got to
yeah,
go.
Yeah.
Like that's admirable.
You know what my confession is, dog? You got to go. And I've seen a lot of presidents go before I went. I was like, no, you got to go. No, literally, how many presidents I'm on now? Speed. This is the fourth president now. My fourth president. No, you got to go. And so the other day, we had a pancakes with the press, and they was trying to get me like, okay, well, we're going to put you over here with the bacon and the pancakes. I was like, no, I can't serve bacon. Mm-mm. Oh, I can't serve bacon. I can do something else, but I can't serve bacon. Why not? I said it's just unclean.
And sis,
so they said, oh, okay. Well, we don't want you to smell it. We want you to be all-
That's something I had to grow to understand.
Yeah,
I was in the truth, and in the food and beverage industry and cooking it. I wasn't eating it, but I was cooking it, and this was years and years into knowing the truth. And it was a Gentile that said to me, you saying you can't eat it, but you serve it.
And wait, and what would get him is they said he made the best ribs that they ever take. Like, it was people who came on rib day. Like, the restaurant that he worked at, they had rib day. And so, by him being a trained chef or whatever, may have you, I mean, he could cook it, you know what I'm saying? He never tastes any of the ribs.
I cook by smell.
And they would be like, oh, these are the best ribs I ever. They just fall off the bone. And every night, after every rib day, I had to hear it. Every night he came home just a mess. Yep. He like, you know, so and so.
Every time I was convicted. I was like, I can't. But it was my skill. It was my trade. So it's like, I got to cook for the fam and the region of the country that we live in. This Southern food is what they consider to be. You know what I mean? So I was like, I got to do something. That's how I wound up getting into driving trucks, to be completely honest.
He did. Rib day.
I can't keep serving my people what I know they should eat because that's making me guilty. And it took me years to get that sense.
And they thought they was complimenting him by saying, you know, you make the best ribs I ever tasted. But every time somebody told him that, it beat him down. Cozy Latasha?
I had a question for Coltie Colleen. Because,
mm-hmm.
you know, for me working in the school district here in Philadelphia, a lot of the parents, like two or three of our parents, is they were still college students and stuff like that. And when I say it's been some trialing times this week, it's been some testing trialing times this week, because it's like all of those spirits come into the building. And nobody's praying. I'm just like, it'd be driving me crazy. So I'm like, as Coach Conley, as a counselor, how do you handle, like you said, the young adults? Because the parents are so young. They, like one of my parents is 19 years old and she have a 5-year-old.
What?
And oh, I'm just what? Like, she have a 5-year-old and she's 19 and she's in her freshman year of college.
Dang.
5-year-old. 19, freshman in college. And I'm like, and the baby just, like yesterday, I'm not going to lie, I had to ball that little girl up and sit her in the timeout chair and tell her, I put it, folded her in half, took her legs on her upper body and put her in half and sat in the timeout chair. And I said, you stay here until I tell you to move. She said, when I get up, I'm going to punch you in your boob. The little girl told me this. I told her mother laughs. I'm
how like, old okay.
She said 5. You said 5?
She's 5 years old. Her mom is 19 and she's a freshman in college. So how do you approach a mother like that? That's She a freshman in college and she has a 5-year old. So how do I, as a teacher, because I don't think I was trained for parents that young. I don't think I was. Yeah,
I remember teaching younger children at some point. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, ma'am.
And yeah. So, one of the things you have to do is you have to like have an approach with certain parents uniquely, like the 19-year-old. You know, you ask her like, "Hey, do you have a moment? Because are you the lead teacher?"
Yes.
Okay, you are the lead teacher. So you need to say, "Can I schedule an appointment with you?" And so that you can have some of that time with her. When you can just ask her, how's she doing? How's school? And say, I wanted to, I know that it must be tough being a parent and you might be going through some stuff. I just noticed some behaviors with your daughter. And you need to start jotting some of those things down, that she's being very aggressive. And we know that, you know, when you get older, the more, you know, you start to have they keep a file on you. And they start noting this stuff about your child, they're going to end up trying to put her in special ed, different, all that stuff. But I wanted to say, for as a parenting piece, what type of parenting model are you using? What type of skills are you using? Because I want to refer you, like, you can just refer to the counseling center. And then, you know, then start talking to her every day. Say, how's it going? Have a good conversation with her. And at some point, ask them, say, how are you really doing? You know, I know this is probably in the school year. It's probably not going to work out for you now, but she probably needs some therapy herself at 19. She had a baby at 13. Because yeah, so that's a lot. That's a whole lot to have dealt with. And so she, you don't know how she got that baby, and that baby probably is controlling her, probably hitting her in her boobs, and that's probably why she said that.
Right.
So you probably just want to ask her, like, what type of support system you have, because you know them. 99, I said 99.9%, if your child is having a problem, you can't blame it on the child. You got to blame it on yourself.
Well, you know, everybody's using gentle parenting. Gentle parenting is the new it. You know, everybody's gentle parenting.
But I think that's an excellent way to ask, because it's unoffensive.
It is.
And it allows you to hear and listen and see what they... My coach, Gabor. We're gonna wrap it up because Rev got some food here.
I sure do.
And she gonna make me want some food.
First of all, Coach Gabor, how are you feeling? How are you feeling?
I am much, much better. I want to thank all of you guys for prayer.
Hallelujah.
I've been breathing. I can talk again.
Hallelujah.
I still have a lot of swelling, which is why I haven't turned on my camera. My body is not back to what it was, because I swole up. You know, the movie, I know, who else in the movie Mask with Cher? Remember back in the day?
Yeah.
I looked like that man on the movie. I look, oh, my face. Oh, my God.
Family, listen, I got me a bowl of my baby made sushi bowls with grilled salmon.
I'm glad you said with grilled salmon, because there's no raw fish.
No, we don't. No, even if I came with you, I want to eat raw stuff. But and it's sitting right in front of me, family. And I'm if I don't go ahead and log off, I'm gonna log off my camera, and y'all gonna hear on the mic. So,
these dogs poop.
What? Baby?
About the third time.
Oh my God. It's okay, man. We love y'all.
I think we may be back on schedule.
I have one question for Kosi Joy. Are we meeting tomorrow?
Is she here? I don't think she's here, baby.
You might have to reach out to her via text.
Yeah, you might have to text her.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right, family. I think we're back on schedule. We'll see what the background look like next time we see y'all.
I'm a campaign. Like, how many people vote for this campaign? This background, maybe we can, you know, convince him that it's a nice background. I'm campaigning for
it. I just want it to be a simple transition. Right. I like it too.
We'll try whatever he gonna do next week. So if it's different, y'all don't We're just gonna see what's the better background. Maybe we have a vote for it.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom, family.
Love y'all. See you next time.
We love y'all. Shabbat shalom. Y'all willing? Y'all survive the week. Fight. Okay. Fight.
As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death,
hey.
Fear no evil.
Psalms 91.
Yah is with us.
Hey.
His rod and his staff, they comfort me. So I prepare the table before me.
I say yes.
Fight.
I'm too blessed to be stressed. Nevertheless, I must confess. Yes, this is Project Wake Up Jacob. On the Sabbath we rest and reflect upon his goodness. Because we are guided by the Ruach Kodesh. Yes, whenever I get dressed, yes, I'm dripping Kodesh fresh. Yes.